world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, we'll feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events and trends. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair because the lecture hall is about to begin.
Now, the fifth mass extinction is the one that's best known to people. It's the end Cretaceous extinction about 65 million years ago. I'm sure you're all generally aware of this. And this is when we lost the dinosaurs, the ammonites, and a number of other groups. And it's virtually unanimously accepted now by scientists that the cause of this mass extinction was an asteroid or large meteor striking the Earth. It was about 10 kilometers in diameter, and it struck an area just off the coast of the Yucatan. And they found the crater and the impact layers and all that. So it's a pretty definite thing. And that, as you see here, generated a lot of secondary impacts, like injection of a huge amount of dust into the atmosphere, which cooled the climate dramatically. And so we lost about 50% of all species during this end Cretaceous extinction. And again, over a period of 10, 20 million years, diversity gradually built back up. But of course, the species that were lost we'll never see again. Now, this fifth mass extinction, unfortunately, was not our last. We know now that we are well into the sixth great mass extinction in the history of life. And what's unusual about this one is that it is caused by not some extraterrestrial event or volcanism or some other purely geological cause. Rather, it's the result of the activities of one species, us. And so we actually have some say about whether this mass extinction continues or whether we start slowing it down and actually stopping it and allowing diversity to recover. We've already lost a huge number of species, as I'll show, but it's not too late to keep this extinction from getting out of hand. Before this, when did this sixth great mass extinction begin? Now, we all know that lately the human population growth and development and so on are causing us to lose a lot of species. But the loss of species actually started somewhat earlier. And in North America, at least, it was about 13,000 years ago that we first saw large pulses of animals, in particular, going extinct. And the causes of this extinction about 13,000 years ago are still being debated. Climate had an impact. And in fact, a meteor might have had an impact. There's some new evidence that a small meteor struck right as the climate was beginning to warm after the Ice Age and created very cooler conditions, which we've known existed for some time. It's called the Younger Dryas period. But also, human hunting pressure increased dramatically at this time. And North America was an absolutely amazing place. 13,000 years ago to 2 million years ago, we had probably the richest fauna of large vertebrates, mammals, birds, reptiles, etc., in the world at that time. And this is a scene actually from the west, but right here in Florida, we had mammoths and mastodons, giant ground sloths, camels, horses, glyptodonts, giant tortoises, giant beavers, just an amazing number of things. Saber-toothed cats, lions, cheetahs, pronghorn, all of these went extinct within a very short period, about 13,000 years ago. And again, although the precise causes and their relative contribution are still being debated, there's no longer any question that human overhunting was at least one important cause, if not the leading cause, of this extinction of large vertebrates about 13,000 years ago. Whenever humans have invaded a new area, colonized a new area, or developed a new technology, in this case the fluted spear point, we've had a large number of extinctions. In fact, as recently as 1,500 to 4,000 years ago, when the Polynesians colonized most of the islands of the Pacific, we lost what's now known to be over 1,000 species of birds. That's about 10% of all species of birds on Earth, just within what, in geological terms, is a recent past. Now, more recently, of course, we've seen an increasing rate of extinction. And this figure actually came from an article back in the 1960s, and it shows in white bars the extinctions of known extinctions of mammals in blue bars, known extinctions of birds from 1650 through 1950. And it is highly correlated with this line there, this curved line, which is the increase in the human population over that period. And I don't think that's a spurious correlation. We now know that actually the number of extinctions was even larger than was estimated by this author, you know, 50 years ago. And we know that now that we're above 6 billion people, the number of extinctions is actually even larger than we would have projected from this curve. So human population and economic activity is the ultimate cause of what's going on. And I think a real wake-up call, at least for people that had some knowledge of nature and some concern about nature, was the extinction of this bird. Who can tell me what species this is? The passenger pigeon. What's remarkable and really scary about this situation is that this was, by most estimates, the most abundant bird in the world at the time when the Europeans first came to North America. In fact, even by at the beginning, early years of the 19th century, this was still the most abundant bird in the world. Single flocks numbering over a billion birds would pass overhead. This was well documented by many ornithologists and other naturalists. By the end of the 19th century, this bird was extinct in the wild, due primarily to overhunting, but also destruction of the great eastern deciduous forests, which was the center of its range. And this bird actually ranged down into North Florida, especially in the deciduous forests of northern Florida, the hammocks. So if we can eliminate, in the course of a single century, the most abundant bird in the world, what is safe? It's really kind of a scary thought. Another significant thing, I think, especially for Florida, was the loss of this species. Who can tell me what this one is? Carolina parakeet. Significant for this area because the last known colony of this species was not too far from here. It's within what is now Kissimmee Prairie Preserve State Park in a cypress slough just off the Kissimmee River. And this it existed until at least this colony until the, at least the 1930s. But because this species posed some damage to crops, although it whether it was economically that important, we don't know. It was deliberately driven to extinction, shot to extinction. Of course, everything's connected. We know that now that this species was apparently the primary disperser of cypress seeds, both bald cypress and pond cypress. And these don't get along too well or get around too well on their own. They need dispersers. And so with the extinction of the Carolina parakeet, we probably have limited the ability of cypress to colonize new sites and to intermix genes with other populations, which keeps the species healthy. So finally, though, we do have a law, a very powerful law, really, that was designed to protect species from extinction. And in fact, the law had even a more lofty goal. I think one of the most visionary goals you'll see in any piece of law, at least in the history of the United States. The first stated goal is to provide a means whereby the ecosystems upon which these threatened and endangered species depend may be conserved. So it's not only concerned with saving species, but with entire ecosystems. Now, unfortunately, if you read through the original act, the Endangered Species Act of 1973, which was the first significant act, you'll never see the word ecosystem mentioned again after this preamble, this statement in the preamble. So Congress provided absolutely no guidance or direction to the agencies on how they would actually protect ecosystems. And so as a result, in general, the Endangered Species Act has been very important in preventing some extinctions, but many, many more extinctions still have occurred because we failed to protect entire ecosystems. And as ecosystems decline, so do the species associated with them. And so in general, the act has been implemented site by site, project by project, species by species, without a lot of consideration for the big picture, the broad context of conservation that is the theme of my talk today. And this is kind of a pathetic example of that kind of thinking. You know, we've gotten to the point of drawing a fence around a single burrow of a burrowing owl. This sign, though, ironically, is incorrect. The brewing owl is not a listed endangered species. It is protected by law by the Migratory Bird Treaty Act of, I think, 1914. But ironically, also, the brewing owl is actually not a migratory species. So there's lots of ironies in the law. But still, this picture came from the Keys. I forget which key, down in Monroe County. But it just shows we are not protecting ecosystems. We have mostly last-ditch efforts to protect species. And so whereas human hunting, especially of large animals, and also the introduction of cats and rats and other predators to islands was the main cause of extinctions up until quite recently, over the last 150 to 200 years, direct habitat destruction is the leading proximate or immediate cause of extinction. So this map shows what's happened to North America in particular. This is the human footprint. It's defined here by human population density, transformation of the land, you know, conversion of natural habitat to agriculture and urban areas, for example. Accessibility, especially by roads, so road density is a leading figure here, and electrical power line infrastructure. And you can see that here in the east, you know, especially the eastern seaboard, the Midwest, and increasingly in much of the south, we have the highest degree of transformation. That's the red. And the only areas that are relatively intact, the dark green, are up in northern Canada. But even then, you can see the roads and the power lines and other infrastructure that is eating into those areas. So it's no wonder then, with this level of human impact, that we've destroyed a lot of natural habitat. And again, that's what's mainly driving species, not just animals anymore, but plants as well, to extinction. Now, some kinds of ecosystems or habitats are more threatened than others. Now, a few years ago, well, it's been over 10 years ago now, I and a couple colleagues did a review of endangered ecosystems of the United States in terms of their extent of decline and degradation and vulnerability to further lost. And it was kind of a surprise, well, not really, but what most people think about when they think about habitat destruction is maybe loss of forests, loss of wetlands, but actually the most endangered ecosystems in terms of extent of decline and degradation, and some have been lost entirely, are grasslands, savannas, barrens, which is a kind of broad term including a lot of treeless areas, rock outcrops, cedar barrens, and so on, and shrublands. Okay, so nationwide, these have been the ecosystem types, generally speaking, that have declined the most and are in greatest danger. And this is also true globally. A recent, and it's hard to read the red here, but a recent paper here by Hoekstra and colleagues showed that worldwide, temperate grasslands, savannas, and shrublands are the most endangered systems. It's not the tropical forests, although some of them, especially the tropical and subtropical dry forests, are also up there. But this is kind of an interesting measure. It's a measure of the habitat, the ratio of the habitat converted to habitat protected. That's what's in red that you can't read too well. And then you look at that ratio, and for temperate grasslands, savannas, and shrublands, it's 10 to 1, much higher than any other major ecosystem type. So those are justifiably priorities for conservation and restoration, where we still have pieces remaining. Now, Florida has a wealth of grassland, savanna, and shrubland types of systems. Many of them are subtropical, but they actually fit into this larger category of temperate rather than into tropical. They didn't separate out subtropical. This is the Florida dry prairie. It's an ecosystem type that most people do not know about, in part because it's declined by about 90%. But it's basically just to the west of us. It's the largest concentration of Florida dry prairie was in the Kissimmee River Basin. And the largest remaining piece is in Kissimmee Prairie Preserve, which, as I mentioned, was also had the last known breeding colony of Carolina parakeets. And this picture was taken at Kissimmee Prairie Preserve, where my students and I are conducting some research, especially on this creature, the Florida grasshopper sparrow, which is a listed endangered species. And you know, people get most excited about what's often called charismatic megavertebrates, you know, the Florida panther, the grizzly bear, the polar bear, wolves, elephants, pandas, you know, all those, the cuddly ones, or we think they're cuddly, they're not really so cuddly. But, you know, it's kind of hard to raise support for a sparrow. But in fact, the Florida grasshopper sparrow is the flagship species of the Florida dry prairie. And if we met the needs of the grasshopper sparrow, we probably would protect most of the other species in that system. Not all. No umbrella is ever perfect or complete. But we do a pretty good job. And so we're paying a lot of attention to the needs of this species, as well as co-occurring grassland birds, some of which are also good indicators and have slightly different habitat requirements than this one. The major ecosystem type that we've lost throughout the Southeast was longleaf pine. Longleaf pine savannas, which included flatwoods, as well as the higher, drier, high pine or sandhills communities. There's virtually no virgin longleaf pine left. There's a few little examples, like the Wade Tract near Thomasville, Georgia, a few spots on Eglin Air Force Base out in the western part of the Panhandle. You know, a few, you know, half an acre here and there. But in general, we have less than, it's probably about one thousandth of 1% of the old growth longleaf pine left. But we have some second growth like this here, and you can't see it too well with the light, but basically it's a very open understory of grasses and low palmetto and many different forbs or wildflowers. And you can see how open the structure is. So this is really a savanna. It's not a forest. It's a grassland with scattered trees. In the background, what you see has replaced longleaf pine in much of the forest-growing areas of northern Florida and much of the rest of the South, dense plantations of, in this case, slash pine, but also sand pine and loblolly pine. And these have a very different structure and do not provide suitable habitat for the rare species associated with longleaf pine. So this was the original extent of longleaf pine. It was the dominant vegetation of the southeastern coastal plain. Dominant upland vegetation. It's declined on the order of 97% to 98% or even more since European settlement. And this isn't all something that happened in the distant past. If you look just at the period from 1936 to 1987, there was an 88% of longleaf pine in that 50-year period just in Florida. So these are data just in Florida. Now, in addition to losses to agriculture, logging, and increasingly urbanization, longleaf pine, like many systems, suffered from lack of fire. And in fact, if we remember, we look at those temperate grasslands, barrens, shrublands, savannas, one thing that they all have in common, virtually, with very few exceptions, is a dependence on regular fire. So fire was really the key process that held these systems together and kept them open and diverse. And people suppressed or excluded fire deliberately, but also by fragmenting the landscape with roads and agricultural fields, clear cuts, urban areas, and so on, we prevented the natural spread of fire. And even today, even in our managed areas, even in our state parks and national forests and so on, they are not burning nearly enough. And these systems are closing in, and we're losing the diversity associated with these systems. Now, the best known species associated with longleaf pine, primarily, is the red-cockaded woodpecker, which is listed as endangered. But this is one of literally dozens of species associated with longleaf pine that are threatened or endangered or should be listed as such, have declined dramatically. The red-cockaded woodpecker is not a perfect umbrella for all these other species. It helps, but we know that some species, for example, fox squirrels, which is awful, which have also suffered major declines, need more oaks and other hardwoods in their habitat. And so they do best with maybe a fire return interval of 5 to 7 years or something like that, whereas the red-cockaded woodpecker does best with a fire interval of like 1 or 2 years, which is also true, by the way, for the Florida grasshopper sparrow and most other species of the Florida dry prairie. Florida scrub, okay, this is a shrubland, although some phases of it, of course, are sand pine forest, but with a natural fire regime, most of this would have been oak scrub and rosemary scrub about 1 to 2 meters in height, which happens to be the optimal height for the Florida scrub jay, which is our only endemic full species of bird in Florida, and which means the Florida grasshopper sparrow, for example, is a subspecies listed as endangered. Florida scrub jay is a full species. It's distinct from the western scrub jay. But scrub, again, and the scrub jay in particular, is suffering primarily from a lack of fire, even on protected lands. They simply can't burn enough. And in part, this is because of complaints from the public about the smoke, about the at least the perceived fear of fire escaping. And so they're not able, the managers aren't able to burn as much as they would like to, but also there's fiscal constraints. They don't have the money to burn as much as they'd like to, or the personnel. The scrub is unique, Florida scrub, in that it has one of the highest rates of endemism, which means concentrations of species that are found locally but nowhere else in the world. In fact, it has a higher concentration of endemics, narrow endemics, than 70% of the global biodiversity hotspots that have been recognized by Conservation International. And most of these are very big, like the Mediterranean Basin and the Caribbean and so on. Florida scrub is packed with these narrowly endemic taxa, which evolved primarily on the Lake Wales Ridge when it was an island or an archipelago, a system of islands, during times of higher sea level between 1 and 2 million years ago, for the most part. And so looking back to the distant past can be very important in understanding what we have now and also in devising strategies for an uncertain future. So at times of peak glaciation, the last one of which was 18,000 years ago, this is what eastern North America looked like. This was ice sheet up here, extending almost down to the Ohio River. Okay, the ice was up to 2 miles thick. South of that, a relatively narrow band of tundra in black. Then boreal forest, which is all this area. Only when we got into the deep south did we have temperate conditions. And these were probably not that different from the natural vegetation of Florida today. Many of the same genera. We can't get it down to species for the most part. But these are, you know, pine, yellow pine, and oak and hickory forests, and scrub. So those were the dominant systems. And they were connected with similar systems in the southwest and in Mexico, which is why we have, you know, western scrub jay and a Florida scrub jay and eastern diamondback and a western diamondback and a lot of other parallels, sister species we call them often, between Florida in particular and areas in Mexico and the southwest. Really fascinating. Also, these river valleys shown here were major corridors for the dispersal of species southward to escape those glaciers. And they also served as refugia for a lot of species adapted to moister conditions during dry times of the ice age or Pleistocene. And so today we find, for example, in northern Florida, disjunct or isolated populations of a lot of northern plants, as well as some animals. For example, the columbine, also bloodroot, mayapple, toothwort, a number of other plants that we associate with, like the southern Appalachians, are found in little tiny remnant populations, especially near the Apalachicola River, which is one of these corridors in North Florida. Really good place to see these, by the way, is Florida Cavern State Park near Mariana. Wonderful place. You walk in there and you think you're in the Appalachians, but it's Florida. But it's this ecological and geological and climatic history that explains that oddity. And then at other times, as I've already alluded to, Florida had very high sea levels that covered most of it. And so what we had as dry ground was only what we see there in the northern highlands and then a few ridge systems, like the Lake Wales Ridge that I've mentioned. And so this provided opportunities for many of these species to evolve in isolation, which is, again, the reason why we have so many narrow endemics, locally restricted plants in particular, and some animals, like the sand skink, for example, on those islands. The Everglades shown here are very recent. They've only been around as anything close to what we know them today for less than 5,000 years. And that's a very short time geologically. Now, of course, sea levels are rising again. And in fact, they're rising much more rapidly than any of our models predicted, which is scary. And we already have studies in Florida, for example, up in the Big Bend Coast or the Nature Coast area, that have documented mortality and decline of vegetation, especially salt intolerant vegetation in our coastal areas, things like cabbage palms dying off along our coast because of rising sea level and salt spray and so on. So it's already happening. Mangroves are very vulnerable. We've already documented an inward movement of mangroves, but we know now that the empirically documented rate of sea level rise is too great for mangroves to accrete enough soil around them and for them to migrate inland. We're going to lose probably most of our mangrove forest within the next century. Most of these models, which is unbelievable, hard to think of, but that's what most of these models suggest. Now, based on a very conservative estimate of a 15-inch rise in sea level over the next century, a report for the National Wildlife Federation showed changes in the Charlotte Harbor area. And most significant here, you see this tan color. These are tidal flats. We basically lose our tidal flats. Well, we know these are extremely important for seagrasses and for manatees that feed on those seagrasses, for shorebirds, for many fish. Basically, they're going to be gone, according to these projections. But this was actually too conservative of an estimate. Since then, we now know, and the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, is now acknowledging that much more likely, even a conservative estimate for sea level rise over the next 80 years or so, at least by the year 2100, is about 1 meter rise. So everything you see in red will be underwater. And this is some work done by researchers at the University of Arizona who looked at relative sea level rise in relation to topography and elevation and so on. So we lose most of the Everglades, we lose the Keys, and most of our coastal areas. But again, this is still a conservative estimate. Some people are suggesting that with the now documented increasing rate of melting of the polar ice caps, both in Greenland and Antarctica, we will eventually see, within a few centuries, but even possibly within a century, rises more on the order of 3 to 6 meters, which would look something like this. Okay, we totally lose the Everglades, even under these conservative estimates. And so we ask, well, what can we do? The sad news is that even if we stopped burning fossil fuels completely today, the climate system has so much inertia in it. We've already put so much CO2 in the atmosphere. The climate is going to keep warming, and sea levels will keep rising for at least the next century. There's literally nothing that we know of that we can do about it. However, by cutting emissions today, we might reduce the level of that impact. In other words, you might have just a 1 meter rise in sea level instead of a 6 meter rise. And the long-term multi-century impacts will be reduced. So at least our great-great-grandchildren will benefit. But the sad thing is, we are already going to see much of the very worst effects of climate change, no matter what we do. And so now, as a conservation biologist, the main thing I'm concerned about is adaptation to climate change. How can we, for example, build corridors from the coast inland so that these natural systems and the species which compose them can move or migrate inland as sea level rises? The mangroves, the estuaries, and so on, the salt marshes. We know that's how these systems responded in the past. And there have been some times of rapid sea level rise in the past. The problem, of course, is that we don't want to let those systems migrate inland. We want to build bulkheads and seawalls. And these new models show that's going to be futile. They're not going to work anyway, and they're going to prevent adaptation to climate change because things won't be able to move as they should. And so we're kind of caught between the devil and the deep blue sea, as Professor Larry Harris of the University of Florida has put it. Our coastal systems, even our protected areas as shown here, can't move inland because of all the development that we're going to try to protect vainly with seawalls. So we can see then that these changes over time obviously affect the spatial distribution of ecosystems. And that's important for a number of reasons. Conservationists consider spatial distributions in much of their priority setting. For example, for the United States, we've recognized a number of hot spots, areas where we have high species richness, many, many species, and especially a large number of rare species. So these hot spots here, this contour map, is based on what's called a rarity-weighted richness index. So this is a number of species of almost all well-documented groups, all the vertebrates, the flowering plants, and gymnosperms, as well as a number of invertebrate groups that we have mapped fairly well, like butterflies and tiger beetles, crayfish, mollusk, and so on. And so you can see that a lot are concentrated in the west, especially from San Francisco Bay southward in California and adjacent states. Also, the southern Appalachians and Florida stand out as major hotspots in the United States. Another thing we need to be concerned about in terms of space is the configuration of habitats. And so one of the dominant threats to systems has been what we call fragmentation, which involves a loss of habitat and a breakup of that remaining habitat into ever smaller and more isolated pieces. And this diagram actually is documented from a single township in Wisconsin. It came out in a book in 1956, so we've known about this for a while. Fragmentation does a number of things. I mentioned how important fire is. We know that fragmentation disrupts the natural spread of fire. And so one study, for example, in Brevard County, showed that as little as 10% anthropogenic land cover, so this is human-created land cover, especially roads, caused a 50% decline in fire extent over the last few decades. Animals like black bear, other species that need a lot of room, will suffer because of this. The black bear was basically distributed statewide prior to European settlement. Now it's isolated into several subpopulations that are not very well connected anymore. And so the challenge here is to try to reconnect those subpopulations because none of them are big enough by themselves to persist in the long term. Even if climate and all that stayed the same, but with climate change and so on, they really need to move. Florida panther, obviously another example. If you look, think back at those sea level rise maps, most of the Florida panther's habitat is going to be gone. Okay? This is, we did a study, some colleagues and I, of panther habitat and corridor requirements, including wildlife crossings in Collier County for the National and Florida Wildlife Federations. If we look at Collier County, look at the human population growths from 1960, projected then, given current trends, to 2030. With that population growth, we've seen a huge number of road kills of bear and panther in this region. And it's mainly due to the widening and hardening of existing roads, but especially to increasing traffic volume, which is an obvious byproduct of increasing human population in that region. The Florida panther is not going to survive in South Florida. It will only survive if it can move northward. Male panthers are already trying to move northward. Females don't move as far. We will have to physically move them northward over some of the barriers that we've created. And the barriers could get worse. This very depressing map is from a study done by GeoPlan, Florida GeoPlan Center at the University of Florida for 1,000 Friends of Florida. And it shows what Florida will look like in terms of development by the year 2060, given recent trends in population growth and if we assume no new protected areas. So those are important assumptions. It doesn't have to be like this. But if current trends continue, and the state right now is buying virtually no more land, they're out of money, sadly. But look at the urban area. I mean, panthers and other species aren't going to be able to move north through all that. Everything red there is urban area. And again, that's if present trends continue. Hopefully they won't, but we have to make them not continue. So connectivity, try to find a way of that species can move away from flooded coastlines, can move north, can move between habitats to maintain gene flow, becomes a real critical consideration in conservation planning, given what's going on with our growth patterns and climate change. And even again, given a static environment, connectivity allows a system of what might be isolated populations to interact into what we call a metapopulation, which is a system of interacting populations, interacting through dispersal, through movement, which might be able to persist in the long term, even though those single isolated populations would not. And so in that spirit, back in the mid-80s, I designed a rather crude statewide network of protected areas in Florida. And actually, it was much more detailed than this map portrays. This was an artist's rendition to use as a slide. And at the time, this idea was thought to be extremely radical. How could you possibly do that? But fortunately, some people in the state government and the Nature Conservancy and others started taking that idea fairly seriously. And so they had a mapping charrette back in 1991, which produced this map, basically a refinement of my earlier map, which served as the basis for the Preservation 2000 campaign, which began in the early 90s and which dedicated about $3 billion from the state to land conservation, which was followed by Florida Forever, also about $3 billion, which was supposed to extend until 2010, but it's now broke. They overspent during the early years. Unfortunately, because now land values are lower, and this would be the perfect time to buy. I'll get back to that. And so this is a more recent map still, produced by Tom Hochter of University of Florida's GeoPlan Center. And this keeps changing as we get new information. And this has been used in large part, together with other data, to guide the Florida Forever land acquisition program, as well as the Nature Conservancy's land acquisition efforts and other efforts. But again, we can still do this, but only if we put a lot more money, effort, and lobbying toward this kind of future. If the status quo continues, we're going to get what that other GeoPlan study showed us, nothing but urban area. So this gets us to vision. I want to close then with a little discussion of the breadth of thinking I think is required, and ambition that is required to move us in the right direction. First of all, we have to recognize that we don't have to let the developers determine our future. The Supreme Court, way back in 1926, validated the idea, and this has never been overturned, that every community, in fact, has the right to determine its own nature. And this includes deciding whether or not that community wants to grow. So the people, this is a democracy, the people can decide if they want more growth in their county or not, and where that growth might occur. And of course, there's going to be more growth. So now it's a question of where can it occur to do the least damage. But in the long run, growth has to stop. I mean, perpetual growth is a recipe for disaster. It can't last. There'll be a collapse. Every society that's ever grown exponentially like ours has collapsed. So traditional planning, unfortunately, has not recognized these facts, and it's basically been a way to facilitate development. And this includes the planning that goes on by state agencies and by, of course, especially the counties in Florida. It's been just a way to modify the landscape more and more over time. Well, I think we need to turn that around. I think we need to look at an historic condition, which in times that were not that different climatically from what we have now, as a baseline, and think about the particular trends that have led us to this current condition that we know is much less than optimal, in fact, is quite undesirable in terms of maintaining nature and native biodiversity. And so you can never go home again. We can never go back to that historic condition. For one thing, the climate is changing, as I've mentioned. But we can start to identify those particular trends and at least move backwards along those trajectories. So instead of having continued loss of forest cover and dry prairie and scrub and so on, we can actually start restoring some of these habitats where remnants remain. Instead of having increasing habitat fragmentation, we can start connecting habitats, creating larger protected areas, aggregating protected areas. We can start closing unnecessary roads and providing wildlife crossings under roads that have high traffic volume, instead of keeping building more roads, having more and more traffic. We can reverse this trend of increasing exotic species. It's not going to be easy, but we're beginning to understand more and more the science behind how these species invade, what enables these species to invade, and also how to control them. But we need to put effort into it. This means dollars. And we can reverse then this declining quality of life for people and start building a better quality of life for ourselves, for our children and grandchildren, and on down the line. We don't have to accept continual impoverishment of the biosphere. The biggest priority in Florida is rather simple. We need to protect more land. What we have here, and you can all see this everywhere in the state, is we're going from this kind of gradient from urban areas to wild land, where we had, you know, agricultural land and semi-improved pastures and forest land and so on in between, to a very sharp boundary now between urban area and protected lands. And that Florida 2060 study I showed you showed nothing but urban area and urban area and wildland, currently protected areas, over most of the state. Florida, as I mentioned already, though, we lead the nation in terms of land acquisition, or at least until recently when we've run out of money. The latest program, Florida Forever, has protected over 535,000 acres. That's significant. With $1.8 billion, however, most of the rest of the $3 billion was spent, a lot of it misspent, and some people may ultimately go to jail, actually, over this, by the state, and so we're essentially broke. Funds are running out. Existing Florida Forever projects, those that have already been mapped and on the list to buy, would have an estimated cost today at about $7 billion. But only $12 million, and this is actually now out of date. It goes up a little bit, then it goes down, but around this much is still available in the Florida Forever program. And there's been some recent acquisitions, so now it may be close to nothing. There is a coalition, however, of 16 regional, state, and national nonprofit organizations that wants to get a bigger land acquisition program going in Florida, basically to extend and expand the Florida Forever. And so their statement is, we propose that by 2008, which is where we are now, this was last year's statement, or maybe the year before, Florida Forever or a successor program spend up to $1 billion per year preserving environmentally sensitive land, etc. And of course, now again is the time to buy. But of course, the legislature is dragging its feet and nothing is happening. So it's not going to be in 2008. It's almost certainly not going to be in 2009. If we're lucky, it might be in 2010, right when land values have gone up again. And it's going to be not as easy as it is today to buy land, unfortunately. That's the sad thing. But still, we can lobby. We might be able to change that. Maybe we can get this successor program in 2009. Maybe we can, but it's going to take citizen involvement. And I think we ought to ask for more than that. Instead of $10 billion over 10 years, which is what the coalition is asking for, I'd say, especially now that land values are low, spend $10 billion over 5 years, or $2 billion a year, then reassess our needs, see if we need another successor program. But we really have to act fast. So in closing, most of what I've been talking about today can be characterized and has been, even somewhat disparagingly, as top-down planning. Okay, thinking from the big picture and kind of, in some cases, imposing a certain viewpoint or land acquisition on local communities. Okay, that has its downside, obviously. It has its positive side because we can see the big picture and act on the big picture. But the bottom-up conservation also has some very important benefits. It involves local people. It's a grassroots kind of activity. And people are more likely to get excited about it. What I think ultimately to do is combine top-down and bottom-up. You know, get the best of both and escape the limitations of both. Because bottom-down has limitations too. Lack of ability to think about broader issues in space and time, for example. So to get around this, I say to reconcile these two, I think what we need to do in each case, in each area, what can I do on this site that will contribute most meaningfully to the conservation of global biodiversity, not just local, but globally. So it's the whole think globally, act locally thing, but now just in a very broad context and at multiple scales. So time, we still have time to protect many of the critical species and ecosystems of Florida. Unfortunately, we're going to continue to lose some, no matter what we do. But we can save most of what we have left if we act decisively and now, because time is running out. We have to act now. We can do it, but it's going to take all of us. It's going to take academics and other scientists, but also it's going to take local citizens. And we're going to have to shake up our politicians a little bit so they see what's really going on. Okay, thanks very much, and I have a little bit of time, I think, for questions.